Reading this morning is Luke chapter 3, verses 1 to 6, page 1029. It's the chapter John the Baptist prepares the way. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod, tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the desert. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the word of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight paths for him, every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked roads shall become straight, the rough ways smooth, and all mankind will see God's salvation. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. Thanks be to God. Okay, now that was going to start the minute I stood up. And the reason for it was, does anybody know what that is? Does anybody know what that is? It's like an air raid siren. Yeah, it's a tornado siren. When we hear a siren, hopefully we're never going to, we probably won't hear one of those in this country, we know that there's something going to happen, something drastic, something needs immediate action. What's going on in this passage that we're going to look at this morning is what John the Baptist was doing. He was warning people that something imminent was about to happen. And that's why I started with a siren. But the other thing I just need to get out of my head before we start, and I just want to ask, if I'm the only one this morning that had this thought, we still have on the front here Jimmy's calendar, which is how Glyn introduced it. Did anybody else have the thought this morning when they said Jimmy's calendar, that might be something like Jimmy with a strategically placed brick, kind of, you know, so we've got Jimmy from January through to December. So, but I can assure you all, it's very appropriate and crumbs. Jimmy, how did you do that? That's like, but it's a great calendar. So just to reiterate, do grab one of them at the end. But I apologise, it's the way I think. That just sounded funny in my head. Now I'm going to bring up a few verses. And we're also going to have a bit of an illustration a little bit later. But I also want to encourage the clock watchers. Yes, it is 25 to 12. But I do sometimes feel that with church, we get to a certain time at church and we start getting itchy feet, don't we? It's like, oh, how are we going to fit the worship in? How are we going to fit the talking? We've got communion today and everything else. But if we were watching a game of football or a game of rugby or we were watching like our favourite programme and it went over, we probably wouldn't be that bothered about it, actually. And I think sometimes we need to be a bit like that with church. You know, we can't just fit God into a box and we shouldn't fit our gatherings in a box either. But I'm going to put a verse up the front here, book of Malachi, last book in the New Testament, chapter 3, verse 7. Ever since the days of your ancestors, you have scorned my decrees and failed to obey them. Now return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of heaven's armies. Over 400 years before John the Baptist started doing his stuff and he's calling people to repent and be baptized, this verse was written down. And there had been a 400-year period of almost, well, from nothing from God, of absolute silence. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever experienced silence. The kind of silence where you know something is going to be said, you're just waiting for it to be said. Now, blokes, how many of you have done something you know you shouldn't have done with your wife? Something that you've been caught out for, you know, you're supposed to have done something and you didn't get around to doing it, and you get the silent treatment and you're just waiting for that moment when they pick you up on it or say something. Mine was the other day while we went shopping. My wife was foolish enough to leave her phone with me, and I updated her Facebook status for her to say what a wonderful husband she had taking her Christmas shopping. She should be thankful. Not many men would do that. And it was really interesting seeing the responses to that, because her friends were like, oh, you're so lucky, you're so blessed. My friends were like, this is Lee, isn't it? Kind of thing. So, but we know sometimes there's times when there is a silence and we're just waiting for the kind of being picked up on it. And that's what was going on here. In fact, the book of Malachi actually closes with these words. Look, I am sending you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord arrives. Now, when John was standing at the River Jordan while he was baptizing people, while he was calling them to repentance, people were expecting something. They were expecting somebody to come, because this was the closing parts of the Old Testament as they had it. They knew something was going to happen. They knew something was going to be said. John would have had their attention also because of the way he was dressed. Those of you that know your Bibles know that John was quite an outstanding character. He didn't shop at places like Primark and places like that. He wore a kind of outfit that was made of like camel hair, and he ate locusts and wild honey, so he would have been a candidate for celebrity because of the type of food he ate. But people would have seen him, and they would have looked at what he was wearing, and they would have already started to be drawing parallels with Elijah. Because Elijah was one of the most influential prophets in the Old Testament, in Bible times. And when they looked at John, when they heard what he was saying, when they looked back to what it said in the book of Malachi, when they realized the kind of clothes he was wearing and what he was saying, he would have had their attention. Because they knew he had something that they needed to be paying attention to. But something that is really very, very easy to miss is just a little bit in verse 2 where it says, a message came from God. Now, we don't know how that message came from God. We don't know whether John heard an audible voice of God. We don't know whether he was spoken to in a dream. But we do know that John heard directly from God. And people at the time would have been familiar with baptism. Baptism was one of the ways that if you weren't Jewish, but you wanted to follow the Jewish religion, you would have had to have been baptized. It was kind of like a rite of passage. So people were familiar with that. But John was actually calling them to a different kind of repentance. People were having to be made right in God's sight. The Jewish people believed that they didn't need baptism. They believed that they were actually the people of God. They were the chosen people. They were already righteous in God's sight. But John told them that they needed to repent, turn around from their sinful lives and attitudes, and that was the baptism they were being called to. And I want to just read again the bit where it says, listen. Listen, it's the voice of someone shouting, clear the way through the wilderness for the Lord. Make a straight highway through the wasteland for our God. Fill in the valleys and level the mountains and hills. Straighten the curves and smooth out the rough places. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all the people will see it together. The Lord has spoken. Now, does anybody actually understand that passage? Understand what's going on there? Does anybody actually get it? Because I've read that so many times. It's a very popular reading. But actually, what does it really, really mean? And to us today, it doesn't actually mean a lot when we first read it. But to the people at the time, they would have known something special was happening and somebody special was coming. Because in Bible times, when royalty, when a powerful leader was going to be coming to a town, to a village, to an area, they literally made the pathway there easier for them. They smoothed out the paths. They actually reduced hills so that there wasn't a hilly way for the royalty when they come. They went to really, really a lot of effort for the person coming. Now, We might make a bit of an effort. If the Queen of England was to come to this church this morning, we would make it as accessible as possible for her, wouldn't we? You know, we would have made it as good as we possibly can. You know, we would have panicked because, well, Steve's away. How are we going to get the chairs so they look all right and everything? But we would have made it absolutely perfect. We probably all would have put on, Brendan probably would have put a tie on. I would have put a tie on this morning. Jimmy would have had his best ping jumper on. And we would all be like really, really smart as best as we can. We'd want to make it as best as we possibly could. But they knew that somebody special was coming because of passages like this. And this would have strengthened what John was saying, because he was now saying somebody special is coming. You need to be ready for when he comes. But this was more than just a get ready, smarten up. It was a case of somebody is coming and you need to sort your life out. You need to turn your life around and you need to repent and you need to put right what's going on in your lives. Now, the way of repentance was through baptism. And baptism is very symbolic. Water was symbolic of things being made pure for use in the temple. It was a way of saying that something is being set apart as holy. And people were being called to actually be set apart, to be made holy, to be made right for God. And there would have been lots of people there who genuinely wanted to hear what John had to say. And some of those people would have been the kind of people that, you know, they come to church early and they're really, really eager to hear what's going on and they were really passionate. And some of those people would have been people, you know, the kind of people you get, probably like you'll get the flash mob later, you'll get those that are there and they're going to be joining in and they're going to be singing, and then you'll get the kind of people that, you know, they're just having a little bit of a peer and they might get their phone out and they might film a bit and they're just showing a bit of interest. There would have been these people there, but there also would have been those that really, really wanted to hear what John had to say. Now, when I was preparing this, I always ask God to kind of help me with it, because I really need God's help in most areas of my life, and this is one of them. And I was praying for some kind of way I could get this point over that would make it memorable and that would help. And for that, I'm going to need some volunteers. So this is the point in the service where you do look at the floor, and then I pick you because you're avoiding eye contact with you. So I'm going to pick a couple of people. I'm going to pick this one. I'm going to have Vicky. You're looking at me. You can come up here. Now, who else should we have? I'm not going to pick you, Thelma. Don't worry, because I don't expect you to come up the front here. Brendan. Brendan, you can come up here. No. It's not as easy as that, I'm afraid. Now, what we're going to do, Brendan, can you come and help me lift something first, please? Okay, I don't want to panic you, Vicky, but here we have a rather large bowl of water. Okay, so I'm going to place that. Well, that balance there. Yep, that will balance there. Oh, brilliant. Okay, now underneath this, I'm going to have what we're going to use for our illustration. Now, Brendan, would you like to be, you can be the doer, okay? You're going to be the doer this morning. Underneath my tablecloth, I have some things. I've doubled it. That was pretty clever, wasn't it? Right, I have a brush. This is no ordinary brush. I've been told this is a pampered chef one, okay? Right. And I have, I'm afraid it's not Nutella, it's the Sainsbury's Haze, yeah, it's the cheap one, okay? But what I would like, Vicky, I would like you to just put your hands up like that, okay? Now what I would like you to do, hopefully this hasn't set too hard, is it? Oh, lovely, lovely. Can you paint her hands for me? Literally, yeah, literally paint her. You're not allergic to chocolate, are you?
No.
No, that's good. If you could just paint her hand, just paint her hands for me, okay? There is a point to this, believe me. Okay? Oh, lovely. Absolutely. You're enjoying that, Brendan, aren't you? Don't answer that. Helen is. Okay, right. That's a good one. Plenty of it on there. We just want it plastered in that chocolate spread. Absolutely. See? No. Don't do that. In a minute, I'm going to get you to lay hands on Brendan and pray for him. No, I'm not. I'm not going to do that. Okay, fantastic. Okay, brilliant. Now then, let's just plain fantastic. Now, that chocolate spread, I want you to imagine that is symbolizing our sin. Not Vicky's sin, okay? Our sin. And so often what we do in life with sin is we try and hide it. It's like, well, you know, nobody really knows about it. I can get away with it, you know. Okay, God knows, and I'll perhaps ask for forgiveness, but, you know. So what we do is we where's your sin gone? Fantastic. What we do is we cover our sin up. Hang on, let's get this right. That's right, brilliant. Don't worry, they're my gloves, so you're not going to get in trouble. Oh, yeah. Okay, keep your hands in there. Okay, fantastic. Okay, we cover our sin up. Okay, and that's what we do. We hide our sin away. So when we turn up to church, you know, we've got our... We don't wear church gloves to church, I know. Okay, but we put our metaphorical gloves on and we kind of hide all that's going on in our lives. And everyone around us thinks, oh, you know, that lovely, they're so godly, they're so... You know, they do the tea and the coffee and they're really, really godly. They help with the young people. Bit of a plug there, so we need some help. Okay, but that's what we do. But actually, Vicky, can I take the gloves off for a minute? I want them back. Okay, keep your hands that way, right? Okay, now look. When we're on our own, when we're still in front of God, it's still... I'm going to wash these later because they're going to be very chucked again. But the sin is still there. When we really, really come to God, when we really come to God, and Brendan, you can come and sit down now. Thank you very much for your help. When we really come to God, and baptism is part of that, Vicky, would you like to... Oh, it's still warm. I put hot water in it earlier, so have a good wash there. Okay. If you could dry those. And then could you just show everybody where your sin's gone, please? That looks disgusting in there now. Okay, fantastic. Vicky, you can go sit down. Thank you. Thank you very much. But it's not that when we're baptized, all of a sudden, all of the sin just washes off of us and it gets left in the water. Because if it did, that baptistry would be really, really dirty. When we get baptized, when we really, really respond, like the people at the time were responding, it's a heart repentance. It's a turning around and saying, God, I know there's stuff inside of me that's so wrong, and I want to get rid of this sin, and I'm going to turn back to you, and I'm going to live for you. But then every day, we get a little bit more chocolate spread on our hands. And we have to go back to God, and we have to say, God, I'm really sorry, I repent of that, I really want to stop doing that, I don't want to look at that anymore, I don't want to be that person, I don't want to talk to them like that. We can't just put the gloves on. We've got to go to God and be truly, truly repentant. And the only way we do that is to literally either get on our knees, or if we can't kneel, to be sitting and going before God, going before the throne room of heaven and asking for forgiveness. And my challenge to all of us this morning is, let's not be a group of people in a church that wear gloves. Okay? Let's be a group of people who, when we mess up, when we make mistakes, when we sin, we're open with each other. You know, I've got people that I can go to and say, do you know what? I really need to sort this out. I really don't want to keep doing this. And I know that they'll pray for me, but I know they'll hold me accountable as well. And I'll tell you what, to admit to God that you've got some sin in your life you need to deal with is hard enough. To say it to a fellow believer is even harder. Because you've really got to be able to trust that person. But we need to get our hearts right. Because just like John was saying, repent, be baptized. The day of God, Jesus' return, is coming. Glyn's already referred to it this morning. We are definitely getting nearer to Jesus' return. And Jesus doesn't want to come back and find a lovely group of Christians all wearing gloves because they're covering the sin they've not dealt with. He wants to come back and find people with stuff on their hands that they're daily washing and repenting of. Because I can tell you now, we are never ever going to be perfect. Okay? Nobody apart from Jesus Christ was ever perfect, ever will be perfect. But we're made perfect because of what Jesus did by his death on the cross. But we have to keep going back to him for repentance and forgiveness to be made right.